네, 다음 기조연설자 바로 소개해드리도록 하겠습니다. 퓰리처상을 수상한 언론인이자 또 1991년에 출간해서 또 지난해 말에는 한국에도 발간이 되었었죠. 화제의 고전 백래시의 저자이십니다. 당대 미국의 여성운동과 또 그것을 저지하려는 사회적인 움직임을 빚어낸 많은 갈등들에 대해서 좀 날카롭게 지적을 해주셨는데요. 작년에 한국판이 발간된 이후에도 굉장히 많은 논의가 이루어지고 있습니다. 수잔 팔루디님께서 기조연설을 해주시겠습니다. Ladies and gentlemen, please greet our keynote speaker, Ms. Susan Faludi, with a big round of applause. 큰 박수로 맞이해 주시기 바랍니다.
Thank you. Wow, thank you all so much. This is a hard act to follow. Feel I should be rapping my speech or maybe dancing it. So thank you all so much for being here. This is my first visit to Seoul, and I am thrilled and honored to be invited here. I want to thank the organizers of this event and eDaily and the chair of eDaily for making this possible, and especially for putting the focus this year on women's rights. It could not be more timely. I'm also delighted that my book Backlash has just been published in Korea. And seems to be striking a chord with readers here. One of my original hopes for the book was that it would speak to women beyond the United States. But I'm also horrified. When Backlash came out in the United States in 1991, I wanted it to have a short shelf life. When you write a call to arms, you want it to be obsolete in a hurry. But here we are, 27 years later, and the book still rings true for women? This is not good. The most common remark I get from American readers these days is, you could just reissue Backlash now without altering a single word. Nothing has changed. Can this be true? In the country where I'm from, women are living through Dickensian times. For feminism in the US, it's the best of times and the worst of times. It's the best of times. Now I'm going to see if this actually works. Oh dear. What am I doing wrong? No? Can somebody switch the slide for me, maybe? Technology is foiling me. Hi. They're good pictures. They're worth waiting for. Ah, there we go. So it's the best of times when nearly a million women protest a misogynist president by showing up for a women's march in the Capitol, three times the number of people who showed up the day before for Donald Trump's inauguration. And it's the best of times when women go on to launch hundreds of demonstrations, grassroots initiatives, and legal actions against the Trump administration's anti-women policies. And when a record number of women seek political office and win the largest number of congressional primary victories by female candidates in the nation's history. And when women launch a Me Too movement that has exposed and brought down a staggering number of sexual predators in high places, from Hollywood to the media to government. But It's also the worst of times in my country. We have a head of state who openly brags about sexually humiliating and assaulting women, or in his own words, and I'll let you read that if you can. I'm sure you've heard him. We have a White House that is gutting legislation against sexual assault, cutting off access to essential health care and reproductive care for millions of women, and nominating Supreme Court justices who will revoke women's right to abortion. It's a similar story around the globe. It's the best of times and the worst of times for women. It's the best of times when we see an international rebirth of feminism with record numbers of women marching for their rights. In Spain, 5 million women this year joined the first feminist strike to protest sex discrimination, domestic violence, and the wage gap. In Brazil, nearly 100,000 women have thronged the capital to protest sexual violence and the exploitation of female workers. In Poland, 30,000 women, you can see them under their umbrellas, gathered in Warsaw's Castle Square as tens of thousands more boycotted work and classes to protest the government's attempt to ban abortion. In Ireland, one of the world's most restrictive laws against abortion was repealed this year, thanks to 72% of Irish women voters. And here in Korea, feminism is surging, and young women are at the forefront. Korean women are mobilizing in huge numbers, calling out sexual harassment and assault at work and on the streets, and bringing down powerful sexual predators in film, theater, literary circles, and all the way up to the Justice Ministry and the governor's office. This past June, nearly 30,000 Korean women marched against the plague of hidden spy cam porn, the largest women-led protest in the nation's history. But also around the globe, it's the worst of times when nationalistic movements dominated by angry men in nation after nation after nation after nation are electing right-wing governments and strongman leaders. When anti-feminist, quote-unquote, men's rights movements are drawing big numbers, and when women everywhere are being terrorized online. Here in Korea, women are being hounded out of their jobs in the gaming industry simply for having liked something on a feminist website or having worn a t-shirt with the slogan, "Girls do not need a prince." I would love to have one of those t-shirts. Male fans have attacked a women entertainer for reading a feminist book. Korean women are facing rampant stalking and revenge porn online, and sexual harassment and rape are rising at alarming rates. In a country that already has, as I'm sure you know, one of the highest sexual assault rates in the world. This past year, 80% of working women in Korea reported being sexually harassed, 8 times higher than 6 years ago. That's one reason why The Economist magazine recently ranked Korea as the worst developed nation in which to be a working woman, along with the fact that the average working woman in Korea makes 63 cents to a man's dollar, and women hold only 10% of management jobs in Korean companies. The World Economic Forum's Gender Inequality Index rated Korea near the bottom. When a Korean man can stab to death a 23-year-old woman in a public bathroom at Gyeongnam because he felt women had ignored and belittled him, as he put it, we're clearly in an unprecedented mess. But is it unprecedented? I mean, this past April, Alec Manassian, a 25-year-old computer science student in Canada, got behind the wheel of a van on a busy Toronto street and aimed the vehicle at women. He murdered 10 people, most of them women. In a Facebook post, he declared his allegiance to the so-called incel rebellion, that online community of young men who are seeking revenge against women for rejecting them. Quote, "Nobody's seen anything like this," the head of the Toronto Police Association told the media. Well, not exactly. Almost 30 years ago, in 1989, Mark Lapine, another 25-year-old computer science student in Canada, who had been denied admission to an engineering program, charged into a school screaming, "You're all a bunch of fucking feminists," unquote. He shot 14 women and then himself. These days, I'm getting some creepy feelings of deja vu. Yes, today's times are unprecedented, but they are also an example of what feminist women go through time and time again. In the late 1980s and the beginning of the 90s, I wrote a book, Backlash, whose first sentence was, "To be a woman in America at the close of the 20th century, what good fortune." I was being ironic. It was not good fortune at all. So let's look back at that moment. What was going on when I wrote Backlash? Well, the previous decade, the 1970s, had seen the rise of the second wave of feminism in the US. Abortion was finally made legal, sex discrimination in schools banned, and a series of sex discrimination class action suits against the nation's biggest corporations were won. And then, kablam, Ronald Reagan is elected president in 1980, and the right wing in America takes power. Like Trump, Reagan promised to appoint Supreme Court judges who would ban abortion. Like Trump, the Reagan administration hurried to undo women's gains in education, employment, healthcare, and social welfare. And along with the neoconservative government came a neoconservative culture. Women at the time couldn't quite understand where the message was coming from, because it was being beamed in from everywhere, from Washington, D.C., of course, but also from our newspapers, magazines, movie screens, TV sets, bookstores, department stores, fashion runways, and therapy offices. And the message was, you women are unhappy because of the freedoms you've gained. Feminism is making you miserable. Let me give you an example, and it's how I started out working on Backlash. In 1986, I was in my late 20s, a young reporter, newly hired at a newspaper in California in Silicon Valley. I was single, making my own living, and I was proud to be independent. In early June, I was on my way back to New York to attend a college friend's wedding. And at the airport, I picked up a copy of Newsweek magazine to read on the plane. And there on the cover was a story declaring, if you're a single woman, here are your chances of getting married. The story claimed that feminist-minded women had made a huge mistake. They had put their careers first, and now they faced a, quote, man shortage. College-educated single women at 30, the story said, had only a 20% chance of getting married. Or, as the magazine put it, Such women were now, quote, more likely to be killed by a terrorist than get married. These dire statistics were based on a study from Harvard and Yale, a double Ivy League pedigree, so it had to be true, right? Well, when I got to the wedding in New York, I walked into a hall full of college-educated single women in their late 20s. They had all read the article and they were freaking out. "Did you see Newsweek?" they kept saying. "If we don't get married soon," one of them told me, "we're going to be crazy cat ladies eating out of soup for one cans every night." Their panic was contagious. On the flight home, this proudly single woman in her late 20s, who hadn't given marriage a thought up till this point, suddenly began to wonder, had I blown it? The man shortage study went on to be plastered on the front pages of virtually every major newspaper, got top billing on TV news programs, was featured in TV shows, Hollywood movies, fashion magazines, dating service ads, greeting cards, even a national bus ad campaign which featured a pathetic spinster posed next to a scorecard listing her wretched odds of getting married. Well, many weeks into this hysteria, it occurred to me to do my own reporting on the story. I am a journalist, after all. And with my very first phone call to the logical person, the head of the marriage statistics branch at the U.S. Census Bureau, I discovered there was no man shortage. The Harvard and Yale professors who did the study had made amateur mistakes. In fact, once their errors were fixed, it turned out that if anything, it was single men who would soon be facing a woman shortage. Jean Moorman, the head of marital statistics at the Census Bureau, had in fact been trying to tell the Harvard and Yale professors for months that their study was wrong. They in turn tried to shut her up. And her new boss at the Census Bureau, a right-wing Ronald Reagan appointee, who was all in favor of scaring women back into marriage, forbade her from speaking to the press. It was only 20 years later, in 2006, that Newsweek magazine finally admitted that their cover story was false. Well, as it became clear to me that the man shortage was a myth, I began to wonder about some of the other claims that were making the rounds about the so-called cost of being an independent woman. Like the infertility epidemic, which was getting huge coverage in the press based on only one study that supposedly found that women in their early 30s now had a 40% chance of being infertile. The media dubbed it the curse of the career woman, and Hollywood churned out films about older career women having mental breakdowns because their biological clocks were striking midnight. The infertility study, it turned out, was based on a sample of women whose husbands were sterile. So it proved nothing about older career women. In fact, the fertility rates of older career women were increasing. One by one, the media's big claims supporting the backlash turned out to be all based on myths and misinformation. Like the claims that career women were afflicted by record rates of mental and physical illness. Not true. Stay-at-home mothers, in fact, had the highest rates of depression and illness. Or the claim that working women wanted to work fewer hours or go back home altogether. Not true. Surveys of working women found over and over that what they wanted was more opportunities for advancement, more pay, and more authority. The backlash, though, had a powerful effect. By the fall of 1991, women had learned to internalize the cultural message that feminist independence equaled a barren life of deprivation, loneliness, and sorrow. No wonder feminism seemed dead. However, it was about to wake up. When Backlash was published, I was inundated with letters that began, "Thank you. I thought I was alone. I thought I was the only one who felt that way," unquote. That fall, Anita Hill testified before the U.S. Senate about the sexual harassment that she had endured at the hands of a right-wing nominee to the Supreme Court, Clarence Thomas. Her testimony, like Christine Blasey Ford's testimony last month against Supreme Court nominee Brett Kavanaugh, was like a struck match. Women across the country were inspired to testify about their own experiences of harassment on the job. Soon, women were coming forward to talk about sexual assault in the military, on campus, and in the workplace. Young women organized groups like the Riot Girls and produced feminist zines and feminist rock bands with names like Bikini Kill. Female artists organized the Gorilla Girls, which you see up there, and shamed the art world for shutting women out of museums, galleries, art journals. And the following year, a record number of women ran for public office and nearly doubled their numbers in the U.S. Congress. The media dubbed 1992 the year of the woman, just what they're calling 2018 now. And here's what I want to say about all that. It was great. And here's the other thing I want to say. It did not last. What went wrong? Well, a lot of what happened had to do with a squaring off between two ideals of feminism: individual choice on the one hand and collective sisterhood on the other. Choice and sisterhood have long been popular rallying terms in feminism, but look at how they were played off against each other. The feminism of the 1990s split along generational lines as younger, so-called third wave feminists defined their movement against their mother's feminism. The media was only too glad to inflame these divisions. And soon we were awash in headlines like "Feminist Mother-Daughter Smackdown" and "Your mom's feminism may just be the cause of your unhappiness." At the same time, feminism got tangled up in the consumer culture. Some young women began embracing what they called the new girly feminism, in which women could supposedly make a revolutionary statement by wearing push-up bras from Victoria's Secret or stiletto heels. And what happened? Well, goodbye Riot Girls, hello Spice Girls. Advertisers jumped on the girl power bandwagon. Shopping was empowering, these ads claimed, because it offered, quote, freedom of choice. With the new millennium, consumer feminism was then joined by a new corporate feminism that catered to the most affluent and privileged. Female executives declared a so-called second women's revolution that focused only on advancing women in high-powered business careers. They promoted how to get ahead books that they had written, most famously Lean In by Sheryl Sandberg, the CEO of Facebook. "What can we do as individuals," Sandberg asked her readers, "to," quote, "get to the corner office?" So what's wrong with that? Well, nothing except that this was going on at a time when income inequality was at record levels and millions of women had lost their jobs in the economic crash. The poverty rate for women in the U.S. was at its highest point in 21 years, and the extreme poverty rate among women was at the highest point ever recorded. This economic catastrophe for mass numbers of women was going on right as Sheryl Sandberg was advocating individual self-promotion for a very few wealthy women. And where's the sisterhood in that? Now, you can't talk about any of this without talking about capitalism. So let's talk about capitalism. Because since the beginning, feminism has been in a long and complicated dance with capitalism. In fact, you could say that capitalism, in many respects, cleared the way for feminism. What do I mean by that? Well, in 1834, America's early industrial wage earners, the mill girls, as they were called, of Lowell, Massachusetts, got it all started. Their bosses cut their already low wages by 20%, and the mill girls declared one of the nation's first industrial strikes. They called it not lean in, but turn out. The mill workers launched the first union of working women in American history. They fought for the 10-hour workday. Their radical vision became the first American women's movement. So industrialization liberated women from the patriarchal home and gave them a new oppressor to confront. To fight against women's exploitation in the workplace, the mill women formed a collective sisterhood. When one of the female workers got fired, the others immediately walked out in protest. They wrote in their petition, quote, "Resolved that none of us will go back unless they receive us all as one." So by freeing women to work, then forcing them to organize, industrial capitalism, you could say, gave birth to feminism. A century later, consumer capitalism nearly killed it. In the 1920s, right after American women won the right to vote, their political victory was swamped by the rising new forces of consumer manipulation. Mass media, mass entertainment, and national advertising seized upon women's yearnings for freedom and redirected them to the marketplace, and told women that their mother's feminism was boring and puritanical, and that young women's liberation lay in revolting against their mothers by buying shiny new products, which may sound familiar, right? Another generation gap in feminism fueled by advertisers. Check out Johnson & Johnson's first ad campaign for the feminine product, hygiene product, Modest sanitary napkins in the 1920s. It was called Modernizing Mother, and it showcased these savvy young girls making fun of their unmodern mothers. So you can see here, don't be a fraidy cat mother, there's no danger, and step on it mother, this isn't the polka. The advertisements in the 1920s told women, why mount a collective protest against the exploitations of the workplace when you can, quote unquote, agitate for a better vacuum cleaner or toss off prejudice by buying a pack of cigarettes? One 1920s ad campaign actually called cigarettes for women, quote, torches of freedom. Over and over again, women's quest for social and economic freedom was co-opted. Industrial capitalism had driven women to mobilize as a group. Consumer capitalism invited women to submit, each of her own free will, to a commercial culture, and to call that submission liberation. Feminists have tried to fight it, but feminism itself has been framed by the culture as a vehicle for expression of the self, a self as marketable consumer object, valued by how many times it's been bought, reproduced, or in our internet age, how many times it's been clicked on. So, American feminism was built during industrial capitalism and almost dismantled under consumer capitalism. Two versions of capitalism and two versions of feminism. But guess what? Consumer capitalism in the US is dependent on industrial capitalism in the rest of the world. The clothing, cosmetics, accessories that are sold to a female American market are made by women workers overseas, notably in Asia. And those women work in conditions that can resemble the conditions of 19th century industrial America. Long hours for little pay, hazardous work environments, overcrowded and substandard living conditions. And in some locales, these circumstances are producing the same responses they produced in Lowell, Massachusetts, two centuries ago. Women organizing in common revolt. In 2013, in Dhaka, Bangladesh, 50,000 women took to the streets to demand a minimum wage of $100 a month. This after the horrific garment factory building collapse near Dhaka that killed more than 1,000 workers, most of them women. The women stopped traffic and blockaded sweatshops. The police attacked them with water cannons and rubber bullets, but the women succeeded in shutting down for several days 300 garment factories that supply clothing sold to Walmart and other Western stores. Around the globe, such movements are connecting the dots between sexual assault and economic inequality, between the freedom to walk on the street and a decent and independent income. The 1970s women's movement in the US was known as an inspiration for feminist activism around the world. But now, American feminists are inspired by movements overseas. One place they might find inspiration is right here. Even before Me Too was an internet phenomenon, Korean women were conducting a low-tech version, posting their experiences of sexual violence on walls around the country in solidarity with the murdered young woman in Gyeongnam. While American women buy beauty products seeking empowerment, Korean feminists have declared a monthly consumption strike to boycott shopping and call attention to the pink tax that charges women more for feminine products. In the 1970s, young female workers in Korea, drawn from the rural countryside, just like the 19th century Lowell mill workers in the US, began fighting for their rights on one of the world's first global assembly lines. In garment, electronics, and plastic factories, they had been laboring for poverty wages in shocking, literally back-breaking conditions that left many permanently injured. They endured the longest work week and the highest rate of industrial accidents in the world. And when they rose up to demand their rights and a union to protect those rights, they faced years of vicious and murderous retribution. Their struggles tethered a battle for workers' rights to women's rights. By the 1980s, feminist women in Korea had built on the courage of these intrepid factory workers and forged a coalition to build a women's movement. Today, you are living in a society driven as much by consumer capitalism as by industrial capitalism. And women in Korea must mobilize on both fronts to confront the corrosive and insidious forces of backlash. As you do that, don't forget the lessons of Korea's early movement. You are that movement's inheritors. This summer, a young female journalist in America wrote, quote, "Feminism in South Korea is exploding. Despite the blowback and risks, Korea's feminist moment has already lasted longer than anyone thought possible." Of course, the backlash against feminism has also lasted longer than anyone thought possible. I'm dismayed that the problems I documented in my book are still so current today, but I'm also hopeful and proud to have my book published in a country whose feminists may be leading the way, finally, to put the backlash behind us. I want to thank you all so much. Thank you.
Thank you once again, Ms. Velluti, for that inspiring and enlightening speech.